In this video, I'm going to provide a structural overview of my personal NICs configuration, which is based heavily on Mysterio 77's personal NICs config structure. He has two configs available on his GitHub. One is sort of a starter template. Personally, I found that was quickly not going to be sufficient for my needs, so I started modeling mine after his personal structure. When I decided to start my configuration, I went looking for examples, and there are a ton of different options out there for how to structure your NICs config. Some of them are very complex, difficult to wrap your head around, especially early on when you're just learning NICs, and others are messy and confusing because everything's in a big pile and there's no order or sense to it. Before I came across Mysterio 77's NICs config, I found one by Eric Tossel called NICsFlakes. And while his config didn't really jive with what I wanted, I really liked that he provided a diagram of how everything fit together, and that stuck in my mind. And I decided that once my NICs config was ready to make public, which I have, I would do something similar and create a video to hopefully help some others. So let's dive in. This NICs config uses flakes. If that's not to your liking, some of the structure here may still be useful, but just bear in mind that flakes is still experimental and isn't for everyone. With that said, the flake file here is really just a central staging area or entry point to connect the various parts of the configuration. This flake file consists of two basic sections. We're going to be talking about inputs and outputs. Inputs are where you define all of the various dependencies required for the configuration. We'll go into detail about that in a moment. And outputs are evaluated to determine what configuration settings will be used for each defined system and user in the NICs configuration. This can be anything from single system with a single user to multiple systems with multiple users. In my case, I've got several systems and users that will eventually be managed by the configuration. I'm currently starting really small with just a lab and a theater system, but the plan is to NICsify everything in the network, which should be kind of fun and also a little bit painful along the way as I learn and run into hurdles. So let's talk about inputs. Inputs are largely going to contain URLs to the various dependencies used throughout the configuration. Obviously, we'll fetch the majority of packages from an official channel. For this example, I've included the path to release 23.11. And for other packages, you may want to get rolling releases from the unstable channel. You can add this as well. By defining these as separate inputs, stable and unstable, you can specify specific sources for each package you want to import into the outputs of the configuration. I've also added the path to NixOS hardware modules so I can add in hardware specific modifications based off the different hardware used across my network. Next, my configuration uses something called SOPs to handle secrets management. SOPs itself is a topic for an entire video, but in a nutshell, it allows you to store encrypted secrets such as user passwords and SSH keys, and then programmatically decrypt them and inject the values to where they would usually be stored on a system. I'm using a NICs-specific variant called SOPsNix. The SOPsNix repository is flake-based itself, and the flake allows us to use external flakes as inputs. This essentially allows us to use any NICs-specific options that have been defined in the external repositories within our configuration using NICs expressions. Next, my configuration makes use of Home Manager for handling user preferences and settings that are typically stored in a user's home directory. There'll be more detail about how the Home Manager is used in the configuration later, but for now, just think of it as a large module dedicated to user-level settings or personal preferences as opposed to system-level settings. And lastly, I've added NixVim as a flake input. This is a NIX-specific NeoVim variant that allows me to configure various aspects of Vim. So we have a bunch of inputs that the rest of the configuration can use. Let's set that part of the config aside for now, and we'll move on to outputs. So I'm going to list out the first several parts of the outputs section on the left side of the diagram. Most of these are for more advanced use cases than the rest. The important thing is that they have a dedicated directory within the configuration, and that structure is in place when the time comes. So first up is custom modules. Now, realistically, everything in a NICs configuration is a module, but here we're making a distinct space for any NICs expressions we create that will introduce customized options or functionality for use elsewhere in the configuration. The distinction here is that these modules could also be shared outside of your configuration because while they are custom configuration modules, they would only enable you to more effectively change settings within your configurations as opposed to defining settings themselves. These modules are divided into NixOS and Home Manager directories to keep system or host level modules separate from user or home level modules. A quick note on the pathing in the diagram. Every time you see a dot slash in the diagram, it refers to the root of the nixconfig as opposed to where the text appears within the diagram. I realized partway through that this may cause some confusion, but I continued with it anyway, so now you know. The next part of the structure is overlays. Now, the best way to think about overlays in my mind is they are custom overrides or modifications or patches to existing packages that are available through the inputs. So for a very rudimentary example, let's say that for whatever reason, there is a package that you want to use and there is some quirk with the release that doesn't quite work nicely with something else you use. You need to tweak something in the source code so that it works nicely in your environment, but you don't want to actually modify the source itself. You could write some patch code just for your use case and apply it as an overlay to stabilize your system. There are a lot of other use cases, such as overriding the version that is passed through the official channels that you're linked up to in the inputs, but I won't go into any more detail here. You can read more about them in the official docs, which I'll include a link to below. The important part of the context here is that should the need arise to use an overlay, there is a distinct place in the structure to keep it organized. Next up, we'll talk about custom packages. Now, this is where I'll bring up something that's honestly a pain in the ass about the world of Nix. The word Nix itself is overused. Nix the language, Nix the package manager, NixOS, file.nix, some package.nix, slash Nix, Nix packages. Which leads me to the next word, packages. The official source of packages for Nix is, of course, Nix packages. In many Nix configurations, the architecture-specific packages from that official source are imported to a PKGS attribute set, packages, and then that set key name is passed as an argument to the various expressions within the configuration. Calling it packages instead of Nix packages at this point is kind of confusing, albeit you have less to type when you're passing arguments and whatnot, but it will make more sense in a moment. Back to this packages directory in our structure, it's specifically for housing our own custom written packages. If they are custom packages, you might be asking, why call the directory just packages? That's a great question, and really, you can name it custom packages or whatever if you want. But similar to custom modules being in the modules directory, we know that anything we store here is something custom that we've written ourselves. There's no other reason to store a module or package in these directories unless we wrote them ourselves. So keeping the name short is a tad cleaner. Further to that though, when these custom packages are added or connected to the flake, they're actually added to the same packages attribute set that we imported the official packages to. And in this way, all of the official and custom packages you'll use throughout the configuration files can be accessed through the same set and passed as arguments throughout the configuration. So with that out of the way, and hopefully adding more clarity than confusion, the next question might be, what is a custom package and why would I have one? This won't be for everybody, but if you need a package for something and can't find the right solution in an existing package, you could package your own code and add it to your environment from here. Similar to custom modules, you would ideally do this in a way that you could publish the package upstream to an official channel for others to use. But until you do that, you can house the code here in its own location of the structure. All right, the next output in the structure is a shell file. This is a specialized shell used specifically for development and admin tasks specific to the Nix config, so that you can quickly access a set of utilities that you don't necessarily want available everywhere else you would be using a terminal on your system. The typical use case is bootstrapping the configuration on a new host. You install Nix, you clone the repo, instantiate the custom shell, and then you're able to quickly run all of the secrets management tasks needed to install the configuration and get it running. Now, you could do something similar by running nix-shell-p and then adding the specific packages you want, but this way we don't have to type it out all the time. The really cool part about this is we can use it in conjunction with an environment config file so that whenever we're in our Nix config directory, Nix will automatically instantiate the custom shell for us. The last output on this side of the structure is a formatter. This is a command line tool that checks formatting of your Nix files so that they're all well formed. It's very handy early on, or depending on the host, if you don't have your in-editor LSPs or formatters or linters set up. As mentioned, the outputs we're going through on this side are a little bit more advanced in use case, perhaps with the exception of the formatter and the shell. The important thing is that they have a place in the structure so that when the time comes, we know where to store them and how they fit into the rest of the configuration. Hosts and home both have some important internal structure to them that I'll go into more detail in the next video. I want to keep these videos around the 10-minute mark, so I'll end this one here. The next video is already available though, so you can watch it right away if you like. I hope you've found this helpful, inspiring, or interesting. Please let me know in the comments if you have any questions or feedback. Thank you for your time, and remember, the way out is through.